as my presentation will be more general. I will be not focusing on the teaching courses or subjects. I will be focusing on the term that it's not liked by a large part of archaeologists, and this term is theory, but we may also call it a preliminary knowledge. And also today, Ariana mentioned this problem with theory and its meaning, and I will try to bring it on and elaborate more on this topic. And I really enjoyed that Roland brought this term digital natives, because I actually noticed that contemporary students do things about 10% quicker, practical things, at the computers than they used to do like 6 years ago. I don't have so much experience in teaching. I've been at the university for 7 years, but I already noticed that they are quicker and quicker in clicking. So we can fill this gap with teaching of some of the general knowledge. So why it is important to understand, not only to see. Large part of archaeologists notice already the huge potential, the cognitive potential of digital archaeology, remote sensing techniques, and for some archaeologists it's even a kind of a metaphor of a window through which you can access past realities. But we should first think what we actually try to achieve when we look at the image, for example, or at the data set we're working with. And here will be only examples with images, so it will be easier to explain to me. So when we look at the image, the first step we wish to do is to recognize actually the function and the meaning of what we see, to recognize archaeological features. So probably some late medieval archaeologists would have no problem with recognizing late medieval remains of Mott and Bailey from Poland on this airborne laser scanning derivative. And when we look here, it may be said that we can see some relics of Neolithic tombs. And here it will be a bit more difficult. However, if some of you are familiar with conflict archaeology, you will see that those strange shapes are actually anti-aircraft batteries. And it is not what digital archaeology or aerial archaeology or remote sensing archaeology is about, but it is good start in teaching it. So why are the practical skills so important in teaching digital archaeology? And the answer is very simple, because we give instant satisfaction to our students, because students learn very quickly with little effort how to process the data, how to manipulate images, how to create very effective and very aesthetic representations of archaeological features. So it may be even said that they can learn how to gather large quantities of data, something that was impossible to the previous generations of archaeologists in reach of their hands with little effort. And that's the practical skills. And metaphorically, it can be said that they learn how to manipulate digital reality, because this is the realm we all working within, digital reality. And in the deeper sense, we create new reality, and it gives us a power to interpret. And some students can even feel like a wizard who is able to explain some mysterious objects registered at photographs of some other type of data to the society, because other people do not have this knowledge and do not understand what those features actually are. So the question is, if practical skills work so good, so what is this whole hassle about theory and preliminary knowledge about? In fact, everything I just said was theoretical and hypothetical, even though I refer to facts which I created. And to understand that better, we need to refer to 18th century philosopher George Berkeley. George Berkeley noticed once that we do not perceive with our sight anything else than shapes, colors, and lights. So we do not have a direct access to the material reality. The only access we have is indirect, and it leads to our through our senses. So to understand material reality, in fact, we need to refer to some preliminary knowledge, which in science is called actually a theory which we try to control. And without this knowledge, we won't be able to explain things, to recognize them, to understand them, and therefore our experiences will turn into an ordered stream of sensation we got. And that's it. The reality will have no sense to us without preliminary knowledge. So any division between practice and theory would be for us very artificial, because if we want to teach students practical skills, we also need to introduce theory. And I really enjoyed this pyramid, which was shown by Ronald as a reference to the way he actually prepared the teaching course, where the knowledge was the larger part at the base of this pyramid. And now I will introduce some case study just to show you how I think about the meaning of theory and its purpose. And of course, we may think about theory and preliminary knowledge on the very basic level, and then we need it only to identify certain objects, but also in a deeper level when we want to create some narrative about past and tell actually the story about the past itself. And here I will refer to the example of hermeneutic circle that was redefined by Martin Heidegger. So Martin Heidegger had this idea that our understanding is created within in the circular way. So we move from the smaller meanings to the larger meanings, and then from the perspective of larger meanings, we try to reinterpret those smaller meanings again. So, for example, if we speak about text and understanding of the text, first we need to understand specific letters. Then we need to understand the meaning of specific words. Then we move to the whole sentences and whole group of the sentences. And from that perspective, we go back to the singular words again, because words are often metaphorical or symbolical, and they may have different meanings. And the same mechanism refers also to the interpretation of images or data sets we collect. So that's the example of early medieval strongholds from the studies I did a few years ago. And as you can see, that's aerial photography, which was known at least from the late 1990s. And as you can see, the whole feature was leveled down, so we will not be able to differentiate any ramparts or anything else that was left there. And it may seem that everything we need is in this image to recognize actually the meaning and the purpose of this object. And sometime later, we did some geomagnetics there, and it appeared that actually this feature has two phases, even though it was excavated for a long time, and it had very messy stratigraphy. Nobody was able to interpret that it actually has two phases, not one phase. So when I saw this image, I saw the relics of early medieval strongholds and the relics of late medieval strongholds that was built on the top of it some years later after the first one was burned. And I thought, okay, but there should be some source from the past that we should be able to interpret it, and it should indicate that actually we're dealing here with two phases. Some source from the time before the stronghold was leveled down. And I found it, and it's Urmestrich blood mark from the first half of 19th century, and it actually indicates clearly that there was a mound on the top of this of the early medieval stronghold. So it indicates already that this object had two phases. And that source was known by archaeologists for a long, long time, but nobody interpreted it in that way. So right now we can get back to the interpretation of aerial photography. And when I got back from the source, I noticed that actually the photography, if the image is enhanced, the photography from the late 1990s have some positive crop marks, which can be interpreted like that. Nobody noticed those crop marks, or nobody even seen the reason why they have such shapes. And if we compare this interpretation with the interpretation of magnetics, which is of course more detailed, then we will see that some of those features covers and confirm each other. So the conclusion of that is that only because something was very well photographed or registered with use of digital archaeology, remote sensing techniques, it does not necessarily mean that we will notice it. If we do not have knowledge to recognize stuff, to recognize things, features, to interpret them, then probably we will be unable to see them, even though they are within the image we interpret. So here we can refer actually to the citation from Louis Binford, who said that practical limitation of our knowledge of the past are not inherent in the nature of the archaeological record. The limitation lies in our methodological naivety. And methodological naivety is lack of theory and lack of understanding while we're doing some things. And I mean, naivety lies not only in understanding the way methods we use work or the application work, but also our naivety results from our interpretation of the results we're dealing with. And I would like also to refer to one of the inspirations from the popular culture, which I often bring in to my students, for example. And it also, this example shows quite well how important is knowledge for existence of the past and the way we interpret the past. So it refers to the novel of Philip K. Dick and The Man in the High Castle. And to you who don't know what it is, it refers to it is political fiction novel, and it speaks about the world where Nazis won the war and they conquered United States, and United States are divided between two zones. One is occupied by Nazis, the other one is Japanese Pacific States, and there is quite interesting cultural phenomenon in the Pacific States. Upper class Japanese, when they realize that they destroyed culture, American culture, they start to collect artifacts, things from the past that are helping them to build up their prestige, because they know the past and they have things they can refer to. There is even a huge industry which produces replicas, things from the past. So there is one of the owners of such factory which produces the replica, and his name is Wyndham Matson. And have this interesting discussion with his lover Rita. He shows her two Zippos, lighters, and he says that one of those lighters belonged to last president of United States, Franklin Delano Roosevelt. Later on, there were no United States, so there were no further presidents. And the other one, the other Zippo, is a perfect copy of the first one, and he asks the question, how do you think, why the first one, the first original Zippo, is worth so much? And the other one, even though it looks almost similar, it's worth nothing. There is no objective aura between the first one, which actually communicates us that this is the thing from the past of the great value. And the conclusion of this discussion is that only knowledge is supporting the existence of the past, so existence of archaeological features, but also our narration. So without knowledge, there would be no past. And therefore, I believe preliminary knowledge and theory is so important in teaching archaeology and digital archaeology. Thank you very much for listening.